WebAssembly is a portable way of running code at near-native speed on any browser on any platform, and some people see it as replacing Docker. At one point, in fact, Solomon Hayek, the founder of Docker, has formally tweeted that if WASI and Wasm existed in 2008, we wouldn't have needed to create Docker. So this is the importance of WebAssembly. It could be a replacement for Docker. WebAssembly is certainly advancing very rapidly, but it has not yet reached the level of Docker. Tooling around WebAssembly is not so great. Building, running, and debugging a Wasm file can be difficult for some languages. Let's see how it works. Traditionally, to build a WebAssembly binary, we would need to install the compiler toolchain for the language we're using. For example, if you are writing in C or C++, we could install mscripten to do it. Since installing and maintaining the toolchain over a team of developers can be some kind of a burden, some teams prefer to use Docker as a container to build the WebAssembly binary. This container provides a clean environment, which leads to reproducible builds. You can share your Docker file and it will build the WebAssembly correctly for you, and you can even run this workflow in a CI/CD pipeline. So when Docker released experimental support for WebAssembly in July 2023, we won a fourth way of running is running WebAssembly inside a container. So why Docker as a WebAssembly runtime? First, using the same tool to build and to run the application makes sense because it's less things to learn. Then the containers are portable, so we only need one image. We don't need to create different images for different architectures. The container is also clean, so you get a reproducible build because you're always using the same version of the compiler, and the container is isolated from the host machine, so you can share this file across the team. We can use Docker Compose to create a testing environment, for example, using a database, or if we are running multiple microservices, we can orchestrate them with Docker Compose and introduce WebAssembly containers into the mix. And finally, because Kubernetes supports WebAssembly, we can run these containers in Kubernetes at any scale. Okay, let's start by creating a new project. We're going to use Rust. As you can see, this is a Hello World example. Typically, to build this project, we would use cargo build and then cargo run. And that's it, Hello World. But this is not WebAssembly, this is a native binary for my machine. To compile to WebAssembly, we need to install the Wasm toolchain. And once installed, we can use cargo build and choose the target. And now we actually have a Wasm file. We can see it here. So we cannot run this file directly in our machine because this is not a Mac binary, but we can use Wasm time to run it and it's working. So now the trick is to do this with Docker. In order to use WebAssembly, we need to enable this in Docker. We need one of the latest Docker desktop versions. I'm using 4.25, and then we go to features in development in the options, enable container D and enable Wasm, and that's it. So next we will create a Docker file and copy these commands. This takes starts from an empty image and copies the file that I just compiled in my machine into the container. So in order to build the WebAssembly container, we need to specify platform wasi/wasm, and this will build an image. We can check that by going back to Docker desktop and listing the images, and we see a batch called Wasm, meaning that this is not a normal container, it's a WebAssembly container. In order to run the WebAssembly program in Docker, we need to specify two things. The runtime, this is one of the possible runtimes supported by Docker Desktop, and the platform as usual, and it's working. So now the next step is to, instead of using Docker to run is using Docker to build the image, and we are going to replace the Docker file with a new Docker file. This is a multi-stage. We have two stages. The first part uses Rust and installs the WASI toolchain and basically builds the WebAssembly image, same as before, but inside the container image. This base image is about 2 gigabytes, and it builds, a WebAssembly binary, and the last step is to make it executable. The second stage starts from scratch, like before. It's an empty image, and we copy from the first stage the WebAssembly program and use it as an entry point, so the container runs this file when it starts. So again, we need to build, and this is going to take a little bit longer, but not too much, and we should be able to run the application now. Same result. So we basically have created the same application, the same WebAssembly, but using Docker as the building agent. And we don't, when we start using this, we don't need to have Rust or the toolchain or Wasm time installed in our development machine. We only need Docker desktop and the Docker file. And if we open the image, we see that we only have two layers. These are the second stage layers. So this image is very small. It's about 2 megabytes size. The Rust based image is not here. It was discarded as part of the building project, the building step. So basically we streamlined the whole process and made it easier for us to build and to run and hopefully debug WebAssembly. So let's compare the sizes of the different releases. The smallest file was the native version, but this is compiled for the host. Since this is not WebAssembly, it doesn't count really. The next is the Wasm target created on the host on the Mac. Very close behind is the Wasm container that's wrapped in a Docker image. This is the hostless image we used earlier. So we can see that Docker only adds a very little overhead to the whole thing. For reference, I included the smallest OS we could use, and we would need something like Wasm time installed there to run the Wasm file in the server. So for reference, we would use about 100 or 200 megabytes. That is all for now. WebAssembly and Docker do make an interesting combination. At the end of the day, having more options for developers is always good news. I'm going to leave links in the description to code repositories and a blog post. If you like this video, consider liking it and subscribing so you don't miss the next video. Happy coding!